you're well and fit to get away on a vote.
And what about today, you?
Well, you see, there's a compassionate side of the Whip's office. Once they knew I had cancer, they realised that on chemotherapy, I'd get very, very tired indeed. And I just couldn't stand the late night voting. I could just, you know, it would just be too much for me. And they accommodated me with someone from the other side. And so as a consequence, as soon as I knew that it was such an important vote tonight, I decided that I'd phone them immediately and say, look, I'll get down, you can guarantee my vote, I'll be there.
The Tory whips operate by a subtle mix of argument, threat and promise, although they've recently been accused by some Tory backbenchers of behaving more like an underworld mafia.
When you see these stories in the newspapers about sort of trails of blood appearing out of the whip's office and the instruments of torture being carried on and profiles being written about individual whips who are said to be particularly good at these activities, it's always because an argument has broken surface that would have been in the interests of the party, whichever party it is, if it could have been reconciled in private. The whip will always prefer to do it in private.
Discretion is like the calcium in the bones of the Tory whips. Their office is at 12 Downing Street. The chief whip has a team of 14, all chosen by each other. Like the election to any gentleman's club, it's a process where one blackball excludes.
I had to be security cleared. I was asked to go to number 12, and a very tall man walked in a black suit and a wing collar, long face, and sat down. And he said, we can find nothing against you in security terms, and we're reasonably satisfied. I've only one piece of advice to give you. Don't go to bed with a Russian of either sex. And walked out.
I'd gone out to have a haircut, I think, and just walked back across St. James's Park, and suddenly one of the very senior whips spotted me, took me by the arm and held me in a vice-like grip and said, don't move. And I realised that I was to be invited to join the government whip's office.
I mean, we didn't roll our trousers up or sort of pin knives to our breasts or anything of that kind. I mean, it is just people who spend a tremendous amount of time together who are privy to a lot of the innermost secrets of the party and the government.
It's a self-perpetuating oligarchy, which means in English that if there's a vacancy, it is filled by the choice of the remaining members. There's no nonsense about democracy.
Michael Jopling was chief whip in Mrs. Thatcher's first government. The Tory whip's office is known as the nursery, the training ground for future cabinet ministers. John Major served for nearly 3 years as a whip. Each whip has a departmental responsibility, and Major rose to become the Treasury whip under Nigel Lawson.
As usual, with the news from the whip, John.
Well, good morning, Nigel. I think all colleagues know we've been up all night with the fur eyed bill, and the latest news from the front is that we will continue with it until we've finished, which at the present rate of progress will be some hours ahead, I fear.
That was really his entree into the big time, because it was the whip's office that where he made a tremendous number of connections and gained a lot of friends. And that really was his launching pad.
Over a third of John Major's cabinet are ex-whips. But the Prime Minister is not the most conspicuous product of the Tory whip's office to have made it to the very top. The best-known chief whip is the creation of one of the Tory party's deputy chairmen.
What, me? Oh, no, no, no. I'm the chief whip, merely a functionary. And I shall, of course, give my absolute loyalty to whoever emerges as my leader. You'll have to excuse me now.
Well, no chief whip, in my knowledge, has been
a murderer. I think I can say that with
some confidence. And, of course, it is over-dramatised.
I know of very, very few instances that come anywhere near the kind of portrayal that you see there.
Which are the few instances?
Well,
you know,
what I was actually thinking of was my friend and former colleague in the Whip's office, Tristan Garrell-Jones, who was often seen as being an arch exponent of what's sometimes called the black arts.
Tristan Garrell-Jones was known as the Prince of Darkness during his 8 years as a Tory whip and was seen as a Machiavellian plotter.
We started.
Tristan was always regarded with enormous suspicion by the overwhelming majority of the party. And he fostered that image that he was up to all sorts of tricks. And I think it's part of the Whip's tradition, you know, that the party doesn't know what they're doing. And here's a key member of it who likes to pretend he's a great conspirator and doesn't deny the fact that he loves conspiring.
The fact is that the Whip's office is about the only secure part of Parliament, and it doesn't tell anybody, and certainly I'm not going to tell anybody, how it works and what it does.
The government chief whip, Richard Ryder, also felt unable to enlighten us. And one of his ex-whips declined, saying that to talk to outsiders would be to betray the Tory whip's code of honour and confidentiality. But other present and former whips felt less constrained. In the government whip's annual photo, the chief whip sits next to the Prime Minister. The chief has the vital but largely invisible role of acting as the eyes and ears of the Prime Minister and sensing political trouble ahead.
You've got to be totally straight with your Prime Minister. You need, if possible, to be very close to that Prime Minister. And he has got to, or she has got to, trust them absolutely, completely.
Of course, the chief has got a team of people, you know, all go to the members' tea room, which is the great gossip place in this building. And they sit at tables there and talk to members. They know everything, everybody's opinion on everything. They know what's going on. They know of any plots that are being hatched. And they've got their ears to the ground all the time. All that intelligence comes to the chief whip and, if necessary, it goes to the Prime Minister.
When Bob Mellish took over as Labour's chief whip, he specialised in brutal candour when advising Harold Wilson. Chief whips attend all cabinet meetings and can slip unobtrusively to see the Prime Minister at any time through the interconnecting corridor to Number 10. One of their key tasks is to assess the government's chances of passing its legislation.
So I said to Harold, you'll not get the bill through. And that's that, and that's final. And I'm telling you as chief whip, cut the bloody thing out, because what you can't get through, you just dream about. That was all right. Anyway, he cancelled the bill.
The term whip comes from the hunting field. The job of the whipper-in is to keep the hounds together and hunting as a pack. The whipper-in also has to locate the strays, stragglers and disobedient dogs.
Well, you've got to understand, from the whip's point of view, they want you to show up, vote and shut up. And that's all.
Order! Order! Question is the question, be now, porters. Men of that opinion say aye. Contrary, no.
The object of the whip's office is to make sure that the government gets its legislation. And everything that the whip's office does is a reflection of that main objective.
If you don't keep some kind of rein, disciplinary rein, on the majority, the thing can run riot. And members begin, if I say they begin thinking for themselves, that gives quite the wrong impression. Would start acting for themselves. And that would tend to be deleterious. I think Mr. Major's finding something of that at the moment.
John Major is sometimes accused of seeking to run his government as if he were still a whip. But recently his whip appears to have lost its lash for a hard core of Tory Eurosceptics. We filmed in the Labour whip's office on the day of a big vote on Europe. Labour had issued a three-line whip, the strongest injunction of all, to its MPs, and their chief whip was hoping to attract enough Tory Eurosceptics to defeat the government.
My hidden agenda has been that if we could push the Prime Minister further to the right into the hands of his sceptics, then we might just drive a further wedge between the Prime Minister and the Chancellor of the Exchequer.
It's been very good, really, so far. I mean, basically, Prime Minister's at sea. He's going around, shopping around to find out who yeah. Vote for him. He's having to make his speech, don't know whether he'll be judged or not. It's like the gladiators in the ring like that one. They're going like that after he's finished his speech, all the up. I mean, he's just on the run, isn't he?
The Labour whips are the party's shop stewards with strong trade union traditions. Although Tony Blair has recently sought to remodel his whip's office on Tory lines as a nursery for high flyers.
Just tell him it's Barbara Roach, whip's office. We're just sort of checking out. But he's actually in the building, is he? Wonderful. OK.
Still, Keith First has a problem. No. I'm supposed to sort this out this morning.
I'll find them in the next hour. I'll come back.
The Labour whips are each responsible for a group of MPs from a different region of the country, known as their flock. On this day of the big vote, they have to locate physically every single Labour MP.
My flock, I have to make sure that they are actually here. I think the majority of them will be here.
And once they are here, you don't exactly lock them in, but you make sure they're not far away.
With people that's sick, people that's away, people that's coming back from abroad, people out in Europe, and people locked in lavatories, you never know where they are, but you've got to get them from wherever they are. Into the chamber.
These are people who have not yet been seen.
Yeah.
Unlike the Tories, who've never had a female whip, Labour has three women whips, known as the whippets. Apparently, the Tory whips have always given women black balls.
I think it's wrong. I think they should have. They will have, without any doubt. There will be women whips in the Conservative Party, but I suppose not in this Parliament.
I mean, it's rather ironic, isn't it, that the Conservatives have had a woman leader, but they've still never had a woman in the whip's office.
Well, you've got to get your priorities right.
Meaning what? The whip's office is more important than who leads the party.
You said it, I didn't say it.
When men get together, they have different interests, different priorities to women. That's the essence of being a man, of manhood. Just as women have different interests and different priorities, and mixing the two might get in the way of some of the more masculine activities of the whip's office, which can be not physical in the sense of brutality, but a man's approach is sometimes very difficult and different in psychological terms from the approach a woman might make to the same problem.
I just wonder, what are these more masculine activities of the whip's office?
Well, the general badinage might be difficult to sustain. Sometimes it was found to be with the Prime Minister present. She might not always appreciate a man's joke. She might not understand it too well and think it frivolous or trivial. Whereas to a man, it means rather more. He understands. That's the world in which he's grown up.
Although she became an honorary member, Mrs. Thatcher never felt quite at home in the whip's club. But she did rely on her chief whip to be her key political fixer.
Can you just give me an indication of what the timetable is for the bill now? Chief whip, when are we expecting it back?
Well, I think about a month, 2 months, 6 weeks' time, I think. But it depends.
I remember Margaret Thatcher once saying to me when she was leader, the party, Cecil, what do the whips do? She'd been in the House for 20 years, and she just didn't know what they did.
In the 1983 general election, Mrs. Thatcher was asked about the comments of a former Tory chief whip, Francis Pym, who talked to the dangers of a landslide victory.
I think that I could handle a landslide majority all right. I think that the comment you're referring to was natural chief whip's caution.
Prime Minister.
Ex-chief whip's caution. You know, there's a club of chief whips. They're very unusual people, Mr. Waller.
She got an answer from me, how unusual am I?
Her lack of rapport with her final chief whip was to cost her dear when her leadership came under threat in 1990.
Mrs. Thatcher, when are you going to resign?
Her supporters say that her chief whip, Tim Renton, failed to convince her how serious the threat to her position was.
The problem for Margaret Thatcher was that she and the chief whip were not close. They were not at one. And if the chief whip had been able to impress on her the gravity of her situation, she would probably have devoted more time and more thought to that leadership election, and I think would have carried the day.
The role of the whips goes back to the 17th century. Three whips were given posts in the royal household as a way of ensuring they could be paid. They retain these ceremonial roles to this day. Two whips still travel in a royal coach when the Queen sets off for the state opening of Parliament. And by hallowed tradition, a third whip, called the Vice Chamberlain, is kept behind at Buckingham Palace.
I was held hostage in the palace against the Queen's safe return. I was made very welcome, very comfortable, but I'm sure if the Queen hadn't returned safely, it would have been off with my head.
One of the Vice Chamberlain's duties is to write a letter to the Queen every day about what goes on in Parliament. And one of the perks of office for the three royal whips is to receive a haunch of venison from deer in the royal parks every year. The royal whips also have duties at Buckingham Palace garden parties, where they introduce guests to the Queen.
Here, of course, is the Vice Chamberlain in his special kit and with his wand, this wand, the mark of office, which the Vice Chamberlain carries. It's an appointment by the sovereign, and the Vice Chamberlain lives and dies by the sovereign's appointment. If the sovereign dies, then the wand is snapped in two and thrown into the grave with the monarch, and that's an end of it.
Order, order, Mr. Sidney Chapman.
The Vice Chamberlain has come from the palace with a message from the Queen.
I have received your addresses, praying that the double taxation relief orders be made in the form of the drafts laid before your house. I will comply with your request.
In the Commons, the whips of both sides cooperate behind the scenes to make the place work. They manage the business of Parliament through an arrangement known as the usual channels. In fact, the usual channels is this man, an unusual civil servant, Murdo MacLean. He's the private secretary to the government chief whip and acts as the go-between with the opposition chief whip, Derek Foster.
Morning, Murdo. How are you? It's a very good day.
Through the usual channels, the whip's offices agree the agenda for the following week's parliamentary business and on what days controversial subjects will come up.
I mean, still, if you can possibly do it, then it would be enormously helpful to me to have that on the Wednesday rather than the Tuesday, but I understand your problems.
Once they've agreed the business, hostilities are resumed. Having issued a three-line whip for today's Europe debate, Foster is now determined to orchestrate the floor show in the Commons Chamber. He's delighted to note that a number of Tory Eurosceptics have already put their names down to speak in the big debate.
You've got George Gardner, Theresa Gorman, Michael Carteris, Bill Cash. Most of the usual culprits are there.
But Foster doesn't want to advertise Labour splits on Europe, and he tells one of his whips to make sure that there'll be a supply of Labour speakers to support Tony Blair's line.
We may have to do a bit more work on this.
Get a few more reasonable people in.
But you've got your list, haven't you, of reasonable people.
But what can the whip do to prevent Labour's Eurosceptics from speaking in the debate?
We can't prevent it happening. We should ensure that there's a good representation of people who have a more positive attitude, shall we say, who've put their names in to speak. I can encourage them to do that. I can't go around and say, you must withdraw your name, you should not speak. I mean, if I did that, it would be totally counterproductive. It would ensure that they would sit in there and wait 5 hours if necessary in order to speak. So I don't go around and try and stop anybody saying anything. But you can do a little bit to encourage them.
Now on to the opposition day.
The whips have been supplied by Tony Blair's office with a list of questions or interventions for their MPs to put to John Major in the Europe debate.
Now, interventions. I've got in my pocket a list of suggested interventions, but I think that Bruce has handed one or two out, hasn't he?
Yes. He has. There are a number of suggestions which are all very good and very pertinent.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, along the corridor, a Labour MP has serendipitously come across a useful document for his whip's office in one of the great repositories of Commons secrets.
A colleague who went to use a photocopy machine lifted the lid and there was a document still in. A private, confidential document to brief Conservative MPs about what they were saying. That's fed in through the Whip's office, and we make sure that's put to good use.
Madam Speaker, for those that don't know, this is all set out in the Conservative Research Department brief that has been very helpfully provided to us.
Knowing that Labour's chance of success in the vote depends on Tory rebels, Foster maintains informal contacts with the Tory Eurosceptics.
Well, we bump into them fairly regularly in the House of Commons corridors, and we choose opportunities, and it may only be the odd sentence. Immediately we decided to put the motion down. I have brief words with Bill Cash and Tony Marlowe, for example, to see what they were likely to do, and to say to them it might be helpful for them to keep their cards close to their chest too until the last moment. Because from our point of view as an opposition, the drama of that final hour when people are just wondering what's going to happen is part of the tactics of putting the government on the spot.
Intelligence gathering is one of the central roles of the party whips. They act as a two-way channel, transmitting back and forth the views of what the leadership wants and what legislation the backbenchers will accept. It was the whip's advice which scuppered Michael Heseltine's post office privatisation bill. Most whips seem to have a good relationship with their flocks, based on a subtle mix of friendly concern and unstated threats. And many whips claim to know their charges so well that they can predict what an MP will think before he knows it himself.
We need to know whether individuals are likely to vote against or abstain, and what are the reasons. Some may be pure political conviction. It may be that there are all sorts of other background influences that are affecting the situation, and human beings react very much and to the pressures upon them personally. And all this has got to be known in order to make a judgment as to whether or not the government is likely to carry or not carry.
It follows that you need to know if members have financial problems, if they might have difficulties with their wife, or if their children are ill. Anything really is grist to your mill in understanding the motivation of your fellow members. And if you can understand them better, then of course your advice can be better directed.
So what is the main source that the whips have for their intelligence gathering?
Well, I mean, gossip. You know, I can't think of a more gossipy place than the House of Commons.
I reckon if you have three or four people gathered together, one of them is always either going to be loose-tongued and is going to say something to somebody which gets passed back to the whips, or is going to buy favour by just telling the whips what's going on. You never know.
Oh, yeah, you always had grassers and informers who wanted to do their career some good. So often they were very useful.
The government whips build up dossiers of information, both political and personal, about their flocks. And the whips also act as a kind of welfare agency for MPs. One Tory whip claims they perform 1,000 acts of unremarked kindness each year for Tory MPs who face personal problems.
Anyone with any sense who was in trouble would come to the whips and tell them the truth and say, "Now this, I'm in a jam, can you help?" It might be debt, it might be scandal involving small boys, or any kind of scandal which a member seemed likely to be mixed up in, they'd come and ask if we could help. And if we could, we did. And we would do everything we can, because we would store up brownie points. That sounds a pretty nasty reason, but it's one of the reasons, is if we can get a chap out of trouble, then he'll do as we ask forever more.
The Tory whips approach rich Conservatives to help bail out MPs facing bankruptcy in order to avoid embarrassing publicity for the party. In the Tory whip's office, they keep records of the personal problems of their MPs in what's called the Black Book, or Dirt Book, which is kept in the chief whip's safe.
I mean, the dirt book was just a little book which you had to write down in varying things that you knew or heard about people.
But what sort of thing would you put in the dirt book?
Oh, well, you can take a very good guess. I don't think I should go any further than say you can take a very good guess of all the sorts of things that would happen in life. You would have a good spread of them that would be happening to varying people that you'd heard about or knew about or maybe true.
Well, scandalous stories, I suppose, which possibly are not at all accurate. But you say Member Bloggs told me at dinner this evening that Member Walton is seeing a lot of somebody's wife and not his own, and this sort of thing. That would go in.
What was the purpose of putting that sort of thing in the Black Book?
So that we knew everything about everybody.
Why did you want to do that?
Because we were a very efficient organisation. We were. I don't know where the all whips offices are. And when you are trying to persuade a member that he should vote the way he didn't want to vote, which is part of your job, which is a great part of your job on a controversial issue, it is possible to suggest that perhaps it would be not in his interest if people knew something or other. Very mildly.
This isn't one of the weapons of the Whip's office, what's called the Black Book or the Dirt Book, where you know the details of your colleagues' private lives?
I think most Whips know rather less about their colleagues' lives than their colleagues sometimes think they might.
But it may be useful for the Whip's office, of course, to have it believed that they know a great deal about their colleagues.
That's a different thing. Like all police work, it's based to some extent on a confidence trick.
The Tory Whips have been unable to prevent the recent outbreak of scandalous stories involving their MPs. When a Tory MP was found dead in bizarre circumstances last year, it was the Whip's office rather than the police who revealed his identity in an attempt to curb damaging speculation.
The MP was naked apart from items of women's underwear, and he had a plastic bag over his head.
Dealing with the political fallout from sex scandals is nothing new for Tory chief whips. 30 years ago, as the rumours surrounding the War Minister John Profumo grew in intensity, the Tory chief whip Martin Redmayne sought to defuse the potential political damage to the Prime Minister Harold Macmillan. It was alleged that Christine Keeler was the call girl mistress of both a Soviet officer and the British War Minister. But Profumo strenuously denied the allegations to the Chief Whip. We were given access to Martin Redmayne's papers, which have been stored since his death in his son's house. The papers of Chief Whips are normally kept completely secret. They don't even go into the public record office. The Redmayne papers provide a revealing insight into the mind of a chief whip facing a major political scandal. They show how, in the long hot summer of 1963, Redmayne sought to play down the persistent rumours involving John Profumo. But the rumours refused to go away, and as chief whip, Martin Redmayne received letters and reports from Tory MPs alleging all kinds of wrongdoing in high places. Typical was this letter from the Tory MP for Arundel, Captain Henry Kirby.
Dear Martin, as you know, the day-to-day ramifying revelations with regards to the goings-on of the Kissing Ring, with their multiracial tarts, ponces, drugs, guns, ministers, stately homes, peers, etc., are no news to me. Far worse is yet to come, and if you can spare a moment when school reassembles next week, I'll be happy to tell you, in the strictest confidence, one or two new aspects of the head waiter's case, and one or two other new scandals which are now busily brewing in the background.
While the chief whip was still assessing the various rumours, Profumo came to see him and admitted that he had been having an affair with Christine Keeler and promptly resigned. Redmayne, a former army brigadier, wrote to Macmillan saying that he hadn't been prepared to condemn Profumo on the basis of rumour, but he now offered his own resignation. Macmillan wrote back to Redmayne this letter, marked secret and personal. He said, "If you resign, I shall resign."
No man was ever better served in all these difficulties than I have been by you. We've nothing with which to reproach ourselves, except perhaps too great a loyalty. And that is not, in my view, a serious accusation against any man. It was a classic statement of how reliant a prime minister can be on his chief whip.
As the Profumo affair threatened Macmillan's leadership, the prime minister hatched a survival plan with his chief whip, which they codenamed Operation Limpet. Redmayne's papers reveal that he played a behind-the-scenes role in the leadership crisis that has never before been made public.
As the pressure built up on Macmillan, Redmayne took the pulse of the party. He discovered that most Tory backbenchers wanted Macmillan to resign. But what did Macmillan's own ministers think? There's a nice irony in one letter that Redmayne received from a loyal Tory backbencher.
My dear Martin, if I am seen speaking to you again today, I shall be judged your permanent spy.
The letter was written by Miss Betty Harvey Anderson, MP, who had dined that evening with a junior minister.
I must tell you that at dinner tonight, Margaret Thatcher made clear that she was for the Prime Minister going at once and stuck to her guns when challenged by Julian Critchley and myself on behalf of the Loyalists. So I'm bound to say that a degree of loyalty from within the government would not come amiss at this time.
While the chief whip lined up loyally in public behind Macmillan, his papers reveal that he wrote a remarkable private letter to the Foreign Secretary, Lord Hume. At that time, virtually no one saw Hume as a potential prime minister, but Redmayne urged him to put himself forward if Operation Limpet failed. The chief whip wrote that while his primary loyalty was to Macmillan, he felt that Hume could bring a unity that would serve the wider interests of the party. He added, "I would wish that the PM does not know this letter." Redmayne concluded modestly, "I'm only the party's bottle washer." But a month later, Hume emerged as Prime Minister through secret soundings in which Redmayne played a central part. Redmayne's role as kingmaker was an example writ large of something the Tory whips are doing all the time, seeking to spot political talent. Every minute the House is in session, a whip sits on the front bench, discreetly taking notes on the performance of ministers and backbenchers. The whips' assessments at their weekly meetings are fed to the Prime Minister, and their verdicts strongly influence which backbenchers are chosen to become ministers.
Chief?
Both were very, very good speeches, and I think they performed extremely well.
Very able.
We would say so-and-so is a jolly good chap, and or woman really needs watching. Ministerial material there.
Members, if they are ambitious, and which member is not ambitious, certainly from the start, would take account of that in their relations with the whips and the way in which they respond to the advice of the whips.
Would you ever make use of the fact that the whips have powers of patronage?
Well, very subtly indeed. So you're ambitious, aren't you? I say, yes, I'm ambitious. You'd like to be a minister one day? Yes, yes, of course I should. Well, I'll make a note of that. Yeah.
The chief whip's traditional title is patronage secretary. Until last century, he would appoint the civil servants. And still today, the chief whip retains a powerful say in the honours system.
We got a big map of the British Isles, put it on the floor, and we try to allocate them around the country. You know, so many knighthoods here, so many dames there, so many CBs there, MBs there, and so on. It was a rough and ready way of doing it, but it's the whole honours system was highly unsatisfactory, I thought.
But you, as chief whip, were actually allocating the honours.
Well, I was allocating them to put on a list to send to the Prime Minister. Then he could do what he liked with them.
Did the Prime Minister take your recommendations?
Nearly always, yes. Yes.
Morning.
Morning.
A government chief whip retains other elements of patronage to encourage party loyalty. The promise of parliamentary trips abroad or membership of select committees. The chief whip is always consulted when ministers make significant appointments to public bodies and quangos like NHS trusts. But the whips of both parties maintain that the weapon they most often use to persuade members to toe the line is a different one.
Listening to people and becoming friendly with them is far and away the best way. And trying to persuade them, of course, by argument. And trying to give people the impression that you were a person who believed the arguments which you were putting forward even when they probably suspected that you didn't.
If you can't persuade somebody that the argument itself is decisive, then you can always appeal beyond that to the effect on the party and the need to ensure that the party goes off, continues to go in roughly the same direction. And a party divided against itself is one that is not going to stand well in public opinion. We're seeing some evidence of that at the moment.
If the whip's arguments fail, they arrange for potential rebels to see ministers, sometimes even the prime minister. But some Tory Eurosceptics, like Rupert Allison, who lost the whip for a year, have recently resisted all the blandishments of the whips.
They probably look at my particular whip and say, poor sod, because they probably regard me as being impervious.
Impervious in what way?
Well, I've never been on an overseas jaunt. I'm not a member of a select committee. I've never wanted to be a minister. The idea of being driven to work in the morning by somebody in an Allegro fills me with horror.
That is the whip's definition of a nightmare. A member who wants nothing and on whom you have no influence at all and are not likely to have, who just goes his own way regardless.
But the one thing almost all MPs want is the chance to get away from the House, perhaps for a private or family commitment. But the whips need their vote. So a system has grown up called pairing, where a Labour and Tory MP agree both to be absent and so cancel each other out. The arrangement has to be sanctioned by the pairing whip.
Chap comes in and he says, can I have a pair tonight? I want to go out to dinner. So that happens all the time. And you look at the figures, and it's an unimportant vote, and you've got a good majority, and you say, all right, but you owe me one. Then this same chap, later in the year, goes skiing, and while he's away, a three-line whip comes up, and he's got to come back. And so you know where he is, because he has to tell you before he goes, and he has to come back at his own expense in order to vote. Or he may be in the Caribbean, that's another thing. It costs him more then. And you want him to come. And I never had one that failed to come. And that's the art of it, to know when you can be kind to them or when you've got to whip them in. And there's
no question. Douglas, it's against sick, really.
In the Labour Whip's office on the day of the European debate, Derek Foster's hopes of defeating the government are rising. There's no pairing with the Tories today, and the Labour whips have been working to ensure there'll be a full turnout by what their pairing whip describes as a mixture of threat and persuasion.
The responsibility of getting everybody in here is the pairing whip's job. If anybody's run over, of course, we'll have to just bring his body in or her body in or whatever, or we'll try and get them all in.
Have you had to threaten anyone tonight?
Yes, we threatened one whose sister died. And it's her funeral today. And we had to tell him that, you know, we had to readjust the programme and his arrangements to get down here by 10 o'clock. I didn't like doing it because, you know, we've all got families, we know the position there. But indeed, there was no alternative, we had to come down.
Another MP has arrived for the vote despite a pressing alternative engagement.
My wife is giving birth to a child tomorrow morning.
So you have, that's an arrangement, is it?
I've spoken to the Chief Whip and he said, don't let it be born today, so...
So it's not?
I'll put it out until tomorrow.
Very obliging.
Right. Very obliging.
All your flock are here, John?
Yeah. Well, I hope they're here.
Well, that's ordinary, isn't it?
That's a nice one. Now, how do you want it? Just down the front, like
as
that?
As it comes.
The Labour Whip's office has provided daffodils for its Welsh members as the European vote comes on St David's Day, and there'll be a big party in the Commons.
Nice to see you, Donald. Brighten the house up.
Being St David's Day, somebody has to sacrifice themselves and go to the St David's Day celebration and ensure that all the members who are there also go to the vote or whatever state they may be in when they do go to vote, and when they do go to vote, that somebody directs them into the correct lobby. Not that I'm implying that Welsh members drink at all, but...
Martin's going to be all right.
Derek Foster models his style of whipping on the man who was chief whip when Labour won power 30 years ago. Harold Wilson had a majority of five, and his chief whip, Ted Short, now Lord Glenamara, was told by Martin Redmayne, your government will fall within weeks.
I felt this is going to be a dreadful job, you know, but my object was to keep the government in office until the Prime Minister himself chose the date for the election and didn't have it thrust upon him by a defeat.
With no pairing agreed with the Tories, sick MPs had to be brought to the Commons for big votes. Under the rules, the whips could count their vote by agreeing to nod them through once they were within the precincts. But on one occasion, both a Labour and a Tory MP suffered heart attacks outside Westminster.
The natural thing to do was to pair these two fellas. They'd both heart attacks. But we couldn't make that deal with the Conservatives. They were insisting that everybody should come in. They wanted a full vote. So we had the ridiculous situation of two ambulances coming from two separate hospitals, coming in and parking side by side in New Palace Yard so that these two members could be nodded through.
Because I felt very sad about this. I used to go down to see these people, very often with cylinders of oxygen. We had one member who was actually unconscious here when he was on the premises in an ambulance. But the government of the country depended on it, of course, and we took every precaution. A nurse would be there, in some cases a doctor would be there. So that's one of the things we had to do.
We're obliged, by the nature of the majority, to bring people into Parliament to vote who were at death's door. And to all intents and purposes, we pushed them through the door. I think we killed three members toward the end of that first period.
10 years later, the whips in Jim Callaghan's minority government were forever seeking ingenious backstairs deals with minority parties, and on the night of a big vote would search the whole of the Commons.
We had bog trotters, two guys who were bog trotters. They had to run round all the toilets and look under the door and see if anybody was inside or was ill, see if they could see a pair of feet. If they could, they jumped up and looked over the door. If he was one of theirs, they left him in, no matter how ill he was. If he was one of ours, they got him out. So it was almost a bizarre black comedy, night after night after night.
Here's Lord Jackdaw. He got in the Lords for saving the Labour.
Jack Dormond was the pairing whip who, along with his fellow whips, helped to keep Callaghan's minority government in office for 3 years.
He's a genial old granddad. He used to go on their knees and weep, didn't they? Jack, oh, I've got to go. My wife's at death's door, Jack. I've been burgled. Somebody's nicked the car. My grandmother's funeral tomorrow, that's Jack. Right. I've got to go, he said.
What did I always say?
Go and do your duty, son, in there and vote.
That 3 year period I was in, the camaraderie and the purpose that you felt was like something I've never had before in my life.
Had a very deprived childhood, Frank.
One of my memories in the whip's office is being in the division lobby when we'd been voting very late, and I mean 3 or 4 in the morning, and the colleagues were coming through absolutely knackered, and Jim Callaghan, who always stayed for those late votes, coming through, and as we were saying to the lads, well done, lads, thanks very much, thanks, you've done a grand job. Twice he came up to me as he passed me and said, and so are the whips. That's all we need. Well, he used to put all we need.
Happy day.
Jock
Stallard.
Tory whips reunions seem at first sight rather more sedate affairs.
Lovely to see you. All right, I am the junior whip. I look down the list, there's no doubt about it at all.
The Tory whip's traditions resemble those of an officer's mess. A former chief whip was one of the founders of the Conservative Carlton Club, where they hold whip's dinners.
But I thought, for me, that amazing evening upstairs, when, you know, the big issue was, should we have a general election?
Yes.
And we're sitting there, my first whip's dinner.
Yes.
Very first. I'd only been in the office for 4 weeks. And in comes the Prime Minister and says, tell me, Should I have a general election?
No, the Whips' dinner represents a social highlight of their year.
It's a chance for the Whips to sort of let their hair down and play Whips games, which it would be more than my life would be worth if I told you about. When I said, and they're all sort of...
What sort of games?
Jokey. No. I mean, they're not sort of smashing furniture or anything. They're just drawing up lists of people and having a bit of a laugh. But I really would prefer, as I say, I'd be drummed out of the club if I got into that.
He means the club of Whips. There are Whips, ex-Whips and the rest, says Parkinson. And at their dinners, the Whips would draw up lists of the MPs they least liked on their own side, on the opposition benches, and then choose an overall shit of the year.
But you would draw up lists of people, what? People who were...
People we particularly admired.
And people who you particularly didn't admire.
I can't remember ever doing that.
Ted Heath was Prime Minister and a former Chief Whip himself when Parkinson first joined the Whip's office. The most difficult task faced by Heath's Whips was the bill to take Britain into Europe.
What we had was a chart with all the names of the members of the party on it. And on a daily basis, each whip would mark the chart with a coloured pencil, which depended upon which of three categories the individual member was found to be at that particular point in time. So we had one colour for the wets, the doubters, the uncertain, who could be swayed one way or the other, the robust, who we could rely upon absolutely because they were committed to the ideal of Europe. And the third colour was brown for the shits, who nobody could persuade to do anything other than vote against the legislation proposed.
20 years later, John Major faced similar divisions over Europe, and his whips came under regular fire during Maastricht.
Creating improper pressure on the many members over there whose seats are in jeopardy.
The Tory whips were accused of applying unacceptable duress during the Maastricht process.
Barely a point of order for me, but I can tell the honourable gentleman that I too was in the whip's office in support of a government that didn't have a majority, and I know all about duress. Right now.
Madam Speaker, the House is full of former whips. At this moment...
The Tory whips operate from offices located just off the members' lobby and a few yards from the chamber. Their offices are forbidden territory for outsiders, but it's claimed that during Maastricht, a familiar device was deployed in the Tory whips' office.
There is a sort of blackboard with a curtain across it, and there is a scorecard so that other whips can see the precise state of play at any time on any particular business.
So what does it sound like, the blackboard?
Well, there is a shits list, and with the names of the shits. I was once shown it just to demonstrate that I really wasn't, that I still hadn't achieved membership of the shits list.
You were shown that in the whip's office?
Yes.
In the house?
Yes.
Such lists were designed to help the whips concentrate their efforts during Maastricht. They tended to ignore those on the list and targeted the floating voters.
Well, anyone the whip's office thought they could have some effect on, they never ceased working on. Never. Not for one moment. If there was a chance that they could get them to do something different on one vote, then, and if they did, then that was a success.
The whips would vary their approach to different MPs, depending on whether they felt a gentle or tough approach would be more effective, and they'd play on the social aspirations of their families.
All the Euro rebels were sitting around together discussing tactics. And I remember a colleague telling me that he was particularly dismayed to learn that his wife had been told by a whip that what a disappointment it was that his name would not be appearing on the forthcoming honours list, as she would very likely have become a lady.
It was also alleged that some Tory whips were less than subtle during Maastricht and would use strong-arm methods to direct potential rebels into the government lobby. This was raised during questions on animal welfare.
Is the minister aware that last night the government whips were dragging Tory MPs to the knacker's yard? And instead of dragging those Tory MPs out of one lobby into the other, my suggestion is the whole of the government front bench should be sent to the knacker's yard.
The Agriculture Minister had a whip's quip in response.
I'm sure the Honourable Gentleman heard what I said earlier. Provided these animals are fit to travel, there's no reason they should not do so.
The formidable figure of David Lightbarn, one of the Tories' most senior whips and a controller of the royal household, is the man most often accused of throwing his weight around during Maastricht.
I think there was occasionally a bit of near physical intimidation when very large whips would probably physically lean upon rather smaller backbenchers in an effort to steer them towards the appropriate lobby as the vote was being taken.
You're talking about David Lightbarn.
I wouldn't even mention the names of any of these particularly large whips, but they're pretty well known in the trade.
He's supposed to be the hard man in the Tory office. When we had reports during the Maastricht votes, it was Mr. Lightbarn who was the real threat, and he's the one who's supposed to have made some of the Tory MPs burst into tears, apparently.
Were there reports that you accept?
Well, I do know one Welsh Tory who was extremely upset at the pressure he was put under.
I think that most people I deal with understand me and understand my powers of persuasion, and they're not all sticking them up against the wall and putting them near. I sometimes kiss them better.
He's a great big ugly fella that doesn't stand any nonsense from any of them, and he really makes them jump through hoops, you know. So, and that's the whips. That's a junior whips. That's not the punters, you know. No, I mean, he's obviously doing his job as well, you see. So, and I mean, a government whip's got to be really tough. And he really has. It's got to be really brutal. And the discipline it goes with it is really brutal as well.
Another persistent allegation during Maastricht was that the Tory whips threatened to use the dirt book against the Euro rebels. The then Tory MP Sir Nicholas Fairbairn wrote to the Times,
I am appalled at numerous reports that the whip saw fit to threaten to expose extramarital conduct by backbench colleagues in order to persuade them to abandon their consciences. There has been, as far as I'm aware, no denial of these reports.
There's a lot of black propaganda on both sides. Whips will huff and puff and threaten eternal damnation, and those on the receiving end will say they've been subjected to cruel medieval tortures. I think the truth is probably somewhere in between.
The Tory chief whip, the camera shy Richard Ryder, decided last November to remove the whip from eight Euro rebels. It graphically illustrated the limits of the whip's powers over those they call the old and the bold. Within 5 months, they were brought back into the fold without giving any promises of future good behaviour. And Ryder had to summon in sick MPs like Geoffrey Dickins, who had cancer, for every big vote, along with Julian Critchley, who suffers from a spinal illness.
I can't blame the whips for this. I blame all the rebels wrestling with their conscience.
Hello, young man.
Yes.
This is what you call the walking wounded, isn't it?
No. You and I are the last reserves that the government are throwing in, you realise this. The two last brigades.
We could have been counted through, but knowing you, I
Hitler
bet you...
Jugend, isn't it?
I bet you're going to walk through the lobby, aren't you?
I'm not. I could be pushed.
Well, you're going to be pushed through the lobby, yeah. And I'm going to walk through the
lobby. I'm going to have a gin with Richard Ryder. He owes me a gin.
The Tories' pairing whip, Andrew Mackay, is responsible for ensuring a full turnout on big votes. But the Tory whips were unable to do their sums in advance with total confidence. While they couldn't be sure of the intentions of the whipless wonders and the different shades of Ulster unionists. Tonight in the Labour whip's office, it's approaching the time for the big vote on Europe. And the Labour pairing whip has done his sums.
We could beat the government. I've talked to some of the rebels, and if Bill Cash decides to abstain, that's one less from their figure. So I think that it's in the balance.
Jack Straw coming from Brussels.
The Tory pairing whip, Andrew Mackay, sitting behind Douglas Hurd, passes his latest figures to the Prime Minister.
I've lived through this some years now.
As a former whip himself, Major has questions to ask.
For some form of words on the order paper with which they can gather into the lobby.
And he needs further clarification. The only
thing they have to share is some criticism of government.
Eventually, the Prime Minister seems satisfied.
They want to lure the Right Honourable Gentleman, the leader of the Liberal Party, enthusiastic.
The Labour whips set off on their last-minute rounds of sweeping the myriad bolt holes and watering holes of the Commons. When the division bell does ring, MPs will have just 8 minutes to make it into the lobbies for the vote.
But Geoff Hooney's waiting at members in.
We have the tribe is assembled.
The tribe is assembled, yeah.
For Labour to beat the government, they need a majority in the Aye lobby.
The Ayes to the right, 340. The Noes to the left, 390.
Labour had failed by 5 votes, but they were delighted that they'd managed to lure into their lobbies one particularly prized political beast.
Well, didn't they all do well? It was actually tighter than I thought.
Yeah.
Because as I left, we found out that the official unionists were going to vote for us. Now, when I was speaking to you earlier on, I thought they were going to abstain. And somebody had told me that the Liberals might be a bit flaky, but that was rubbish. And so, and of course, we couldn't expect that Norman Lamont, a former Chancellor, would be in our lobby. And I think that's probably the story as far as the media are concerned, because you can't pretend to be united when a former Chancellor votes in the Labour lobby.
I know we've swung to the right a bit, but I didn't think he would actually embrace us.
But I've never known an ex-chancellor, right? Yeah, lose his pair as quick as Lamont lost his pair tonight. Soon as the second vote came, the bearing whip on the other side came to me and said, you know that agreement we had with Lamont for next week, right? Well, it's off. I got another. He said, "I got another member. I got another Tory that wants to get away before him." I said, "You're not going to be like that, you know." He said, "I can just imagine you with it up to you."
Norman Lamont had committed the gravest crime in the Whip's book. He'd voted against his party without giving them prior warning. The Tory Whip, David Lightbound, said in the lobby, "Norman Lamont can go and play the fiddle in the fields on his own and die in the grass." Supporters of the whipping system claim that the whips are democracy's unsung heroes, as essential for Parliament as sewers are for civilization. But critics may wonder whether there should be any place in a healthy parliamentary democracy for deathbed voting and for those distinctive features of the Tory whip's office: Masonic secrecy, shit lists, and the dirt book on the private lives of MPs.
The MP Geoffrey Dickins, who appeared in that film, died last week after a long struggle with cancer.